What up, nerds? My name's Moya McTeer, and this is Reverse Worldbuilding. I usually host a show called ExoLore, where I interview expert guests, and together we imagine what the life and culture would be like on an alien planet. But I recently started thinking about doing it in reverse. So instead of starting with a planet and figuring out what the life there would look like, what if I started with a life form and then reverse engineered it to figure out what type of planet it must have formed on? And because I'm a folklorist, of course I wanted to do this with some of the amazingly interesting and diverse mythical creatures from myths and religions from around the world. I did a poll on Twitter and asked people what type of mythical creature I should reverse world build first, and they said I should do dragons, so that's what I'm gonna do. The really cool and interesting and weird thing about dragons is that cultures from around the world throughout history kind of independently came up with the idea of these large, scaly, winged creatures who are associated with different fundamental elements like water and fire. Broadly speaking, they can be split up into two different categories. So you'll have your Western dragons and your Eastern dragons. Western dragons are large, they have wings. You can kind of think of them as Tyrannosaurus Rexes, but with wings. And in almost every story of the Western dragon, it can breathe fire. Also, they're usually depicted living in caves, hoarding giant troves of treasure. So they like gold, they like jewels, they like valuable, shiny things. That's your Western dragon. Your Eastern dragon, on the other hand, is much more often associated with water than with fire. They're usually shown to live in or around moving bodies of water, like rivers and streams. And instead of breathing fire like their Western counterparts, some myths say that Eastern dragons can actually bring the rain, which is really cool and often necessary if you have an economy and a culture that's based on agriculture. Other things about Eastern dragons' differences are that they usually don't have wings. Instead, they're often just giant snakes that don't have wings but can still fly because of some supernatural ability. But both Western and Eastern dragons are large, powerful, scaly creatures who can fly. And so let's spend the time to think about what type of planet they might have realistically formed on. The first thing that I want to focus on is their size. Dragons are huge. They're large and they're powerful. They're strong, which means they have a lot of muscle. Here on Earth, it's actually really difficult to get that big because of gravity. If you're that big and you're that massive, then you might actually collapse under your own weight. And we don't want that to happen to our dragons. There are some animals that do get really large, like whales here on Earth, but they live in the water, which the buoyancy in the water can actually alleviate some of those crushing forces from gravity. And then you have dinosaurs who lived, you know, tens of millions of years ago, hundreds of millions of years ago. And they were able, some of them were able to get so big because they had special adaptations that left parts of their body hollow. Just like birds today have air sacs and hollow, slightly hollow bones to help them fly, dinosaurs were able to get so big because they left parts of their body hollow. But dragons are huge and strong. They have solid muscle. They aren't hollow at all. And so I imagine that they have to live on a planet that has much weaker gravity than ours so that they don't get crushed under their own weight and so that they can still fly, which is one of the only characteristics of dragons that is common across most cultures. So there are a couple of ways that you can make your planet have weaker gravity. You can make the planet less massive, or you can make the planet bigger. And so I'm going to imagine that this planet is just much bigger than Earth. Let's say it's about 1.5 times the size of Earth. That will cut the force of gravity down to about 60% of what we have here on Earth, which should help the dragons get off the ground. The next thing I'm going to focus on is their scales. So I actually did some research into what scales do for creatures here on Earth, and they do like a lot of stuff. So you find scales here on Earth on reptiles, and reptiles you usually find in and around water. Those are things like lizards and snakes and other creepy crawly creatures that I actually really like, but other people might not. Scales can do some interesting things like keep your skin moist. Reptiles have skin underneath their scaly layer, and because water is so important to them, the scales will trap in some of the moisture so that their skin can stay nice and wet. Another thing that scales offer is armor. When reptiles, or dragons in our case, fight with other creatures, the scales will serve to protect their more sensitive, vulnerable skin underneath. And then a third really awesome thing that scales do is protect from UV or ultraviolet radiation. We here on Earth are protected from most UV radiation by our thick atmosphere and our developed ozone layer. Without it, things like cancer and other mutations that are caused by high energy radiation would be more common. So we're really lucky. But if you happen to live on a planet that doesn't have a thick atmosphere and doesn't have a developed ozone layer, scales would be a really powerful way of protecting you from harmful UV radiation. So I'm going to imagine that this planet doesn't have a very thick atmosphere, which actually does follow well if the planet is bigger and has weaker gravity. Because if you have weaker gravity, then you're not able to hold on to gas in the atmosphere as easily, and so a lot of it will go away. What about dragons' obsession with treasure and shiny objects? You don't have animals who just want to collect things because they're pretty. Dragons would probably want to collect these rocks because they serve some purpose. Maybe they eat them, or maybe they can use them as some sort of defense. Either way, they're going to evolve to have that type of relationship with metals and these shiny objects, only if there are a lot of those metals around. And so there are a few different ways that you can get a lot of precious metals and shiny objects and stones on the surface of your planet. The way that I like the most is to have a planet with very active plate tectonics. That will kind of increase the rate of the rock cycle, which is the cycle that takes rocks from the surface and then brings them down into the interior of the planet and then brings them back to the surface. So it recycles the rock through the planet, which is actually a really cool process. And so let's imagine that this planet has very active plate tectonics. So let's say that they like these rocks and metals because they eat them. That can actually lead directly into their fire-breathing ability. This might seem very far-fetched that you can have a real creature who breathes fire, but there are some creatures here on Earth who do something similar. There's a beetle who lives in the woodlands and grasslands of pretty much every continent except Antarctica, called the Bombardier beetle? Bombardier? Bombardier beetle. Whatever. It's French, maybe. But it's this beetle that has sacks of gas in its abdomen. And separately, the gases aren't reactive at all, but when you combine them together, they create this really powerful and volatile reaction that increases the temperature in the body of this beetle, and then it can expel all of that hot gas. You know, it gets up to water boiling temperatures. They expel all that hot gas when they feel threatened. And so it's not unrealistic to imagine that dragons on this planet could form gas sacs in their throats that separately are harmless gases, but when mixed together create a very volatile reaction. And if they eat rocks that can create sparks in their throats, then they can combine all of those things together and actually breathe fire out through their mouths. One type of rock that dragons might eat is pyrite, or fool's gold, as you may know it. Pyrite does create a spark when you hit it against other chunks of pyrite, and pyrite is also often found near places with high volcanic activity, because it's created in volcanoes, which follows from the high tectonic plate movement idea, because tectonic plate movement is very closely related to volcanic activity. So these scaly, flying, fire-breathing dragons live on a planet that has low surface gravity, a thin atmosphere with no ozone layer, and an active tectonic plate system that very quickly recycles rocks from and back to the surface so that they can breathe fire. But the thing about breathing fire is that it's super destructive in the wrong environments. And so one way that you can make the fire less destructive is by having low oxygen levels in your atmosphere. Fire feeds on oxygen. It needs oxygen to burn. And so if there's not a lot of oxygen in the atmosphere, then the fire will cause some damage, yeah, but not a lot. And if you get more creative, you can actually think of this really beautiful relationship that the dragon has with its environment to hold the balance of the ratio between carbon dioxide and oxygen. So if a dragon burns a forest to hunt for food, then the forest will be destroyed in that one area and the trees won't be able to produce oxygen anymore. And so that will keep the level of oxygen low enough that the balance between oxygen and carbon dioxide can stay pretty stable. So all of that was about Western fire-breathing dragons, but Western and Eastern dragons are similar enough that you can imagine that they have a very recent common ancestor, probably one who lived in the water. And so something happened that made the Western dragons leave the water and the Eastern dragons stayed there. But, you know, they probably don't live, maybe they live on opposite sides of the planet, but I don't think there's anything I know about Eastern dragons that would mean they have to live on a totally different planet from Western dragons. So yeah, to wrap it all up, dragons probably would have formed on a low gravity planet with a thin ozoneless atmosphere. There's a lot of plate tectonic movement, and they probably have a low oxygen atmosphere. If you like this video and you want to see more like it, then let me know what mythical creatures you want me to reverse world build. Write it down in the comments and come back for future videos. Thanks for watching.